Și astăzi, Natalia Kusendova vă prezintă informații proaspete de la guvernul provincial despre situația crizei COVID.
Ms. Kusendova, thank you again. We're doing our weekly updates. And the numbers are going, unfortunately, they're going up. And just want to know, what are the latest numbers in terms of cases, hospitalizations, ICU occupancy, and where this increase come from?
Great question, and thank you so much for having me. So today we are reporting 4,447 cases of COVID-19, including 1,300 in Toronto and about 926 in Peel. So we are seeing a rise in the cases, as you have noted. To be honest, we were expecting this because, as you know, the COVID-19 cycle is 2 weeks. And what we tend to see is post a religious celebration. For example, we had Catholic Easter about 2 weeks ago. We do see that line go up and then slowly come down. And so this is something that historically has been true for other types of celebrations as well. So we did expect this rise in numbers. But what is alarming right now is that our ICU occupancy rate is on the rise, where we have 755 people in the ICU. And as you know, we have about 2,300 total number of beds of ICU. So 755, that is quite alarming. That is why most hospitals in Ontario have suspended their surgeries or dramatically reduced them to make room for these ICU COVID-19 patients. We are also seeing a general 67% growth in hospitalization and a 51% growth in ICU numbers. So that's why we need to be vigilant, and that's why the government has announced more public health restrictions on Friday, as you know. You know, these decisions were not made lightly, but things like closing down our interprovincial borders, which has, I don't think has ever happened in the history of Ontario. This is the first time that our border with Manitoba and our border with Quebec is actually turning people away through the OPP stopping points, right? So this is very significant and very historic moment, but it is such because we are fighting a very different third wave than the first and second. You know, the variant of concern is on the rise. 67% of all cases are the variant of concern. It is more transmissible and it is more deadly. It's also attacking younger people. And so we have younger people ending up on the ventilator in the ICUs. And this is why we are very concerned. And that's why we acted swiftly and implemented new public health measures on Friday.
What are the current measures, that are in place, and what are the coming actions for the next, let's say, 1-2 weeks?
So as you know, we are under a provincially wide stay-at-home order. We have also extended it from an original 4-week to now 6-week stay-at-home order. And under this order, we have new measures as well. Unfortunately, we had to essentially close our places of worship. I mean, they are allowed to operate at a 10 people capacity, so that religious rites can continue and that these rites can be streamed online for the worshipers. But essentially, it's shutting down public worship services across Ontario. This was a very, very difficult decision to make. Also, weddings and funerals will be restricted to only 10 people. So this is new, and this will be in effect for a minimum of 4 weeks, and pending what our cases are looking at, might even be extended for longer.
We got some questions regarding the police, what they can do, what they cannot do.
So as you are aware, on Friday, we have granted some additional temporary authority to enforce the stay-at-home order by putting a stop to gatherings and crowds. We know that, you know, the vast majority of Ontarians are following the stay-at-home order and are law-abiding citizens, but unfortunately, there's a small percentage of those that are defying the orders. We have seen those large gatherings, the protests, people not wearing masks, not socially distancing. And so honestly, we have to put a stop to that, because right now with our 755 individuals in the ICU, those numbers are only projected to rise. And this is why we really need to enforce the stay-at-home order. The government has recently clarified that these temporary powers are only to be used where an officer has reason to suspect then an individual may be participating in an organized public event or gathering that is prohibited by the stay-at-home order and may require the individual to provide information to ensure compliance with restrictions. So what does that mean? Outdoor gatherings of up to five individuals are allowed as long as they are members of your own household, or if you are a single person household, you are by all means allowed to join another household for outdoor activities such as, you know, fitness, walking your dog, for mental health reasons. That is allowed up to five people. Of course, we're still asking that you socially distance, that you wear a mask. Actually, outdoors, you don't have to wear a mask as long as you're socially distancing. That is, sorry, I wanted to correct that. But so officers only if they have a reason to believe that you are not following the stay-at-home orders, meaning that if they see a group larger than five individuals, like 10 or 15, they have the right to approach these individuals and ask, okay, are you from the same household? And they can request a proof of ID, proof of address for that case. So this was never meant to be, you know, a carding type of scenario. This is certainly not what this order is for. This order is truly to help us the fight of COVID-19 and to protect our healthcare system, which is at a critical point right now where we are starting to use our outdoor hospital structures to host some of our patients. So this is what the intention of that order is, and it is only a temporary power.
I know you have some projections for the month of May.
You know, our health table is doing modeling and keeping vigilant on the numbers on a daily basis. So based on our modeling projections from last week, you know, I have to say it was quite alarming. And our public health table gave us four different scenarios, four different projections. One of them, which would imply weak public health measures, meaning very less than what we have right now, we saw the graph skyrocket to up to 30,000 cases per day in Ontario if we had very weak public health measures. When we were talking about more moderate public health measures, we were still seeing the number go up to 15,000. So today we have 4,500. If we had moderate public health measures, we could be up to 15,000. So that's why we made the difficult decision to opt in for very strong restrictions. And with our vaccinations, our goal is to vaccinate up to 150,000 people per day. Of course, that is pending our supply. So what we're seeing is between 100 to 120,000 per day. So with our strong public health measures and vaccinating at least 100,000 people per day, we see that number. There are two projected scenarios. It could go up to 8,000, or actually it could come down below 5,000, which is what we want. So even with our very strong public health measures and vaccination regime, the number could still go up. So that this is why we had no choice, because every single scenario is predicting a rise in the numbers. So that's why we really needed to act swiftly and implement this. Well, stay-at-home order was already implemented, but additional measures.
You already mentioned a little bit about vaccination. What is the status? What's the current status to the vaccination in Ontario?
So, you know, I have to start with the good news. And the good news is that the AstraZeneca vaccine is now available to individuals age 40 and up. So those of you who fall into that age range, I highly encourage to contact your local pharmacy. I know in Mississauga, we have 25 participating pharmacies, or you can also go to your family doctor, your provider to get your vaccine of AstraZeneca. The good news is that up to today, we have vaccinated 3.9 million people in Ontario, almost 4 million. So that is a significant milestone. That's about 26% of our population. So I say that we're doing okay. Of course, we need more vaccine. You know, the premier has said we don't have a distribution issue. We have a supply issue. So we keep on asking our federal counterparts to really step up the procurement and deliver the vaccines. You know, as I said, we have a good supply of the Pfizer vaccine, is very steady, and we receive it on schedule every week. But the issue is with our Moderna and our AstraZeneca. We keep on getting different numbers, fluctuating numbers from week to week, and then it's very difficult to plan for those appointments, even though our ontario.ca/COVID-vaccine website is working very well, and we have hundreds of thousands of appointments scheduled across Ontario. When we end up receiving only one third of the supply of Moderna or AstraZeneca, then of course that's going to cause issues down the stream. So We're asking our procurement minister, Anand, at the federal level to step up and deliver on the promise. The province is receiving about 38% of the federal procurement of the vaccine. We're asking for more. We are a hotspot and we need more vaccines to get those vaccines into the arms of individuals. But I would say 26% of the population vaccinated in Ontario, that's a significant milestone and more to come.
Ms. Kusendova, thank you very much for these updates. We'll talk again next week, hopefully, with better numbers. Let's hope.
Absolutely. Looking forward to it.